creation. Revelation chapter 21. I'm aware of the time that God's here, your spirit's here. People oftentimes ask, you know, preacher, how do you know when to finish? Well, when God's done, I will be done. And he's still rolling. I will be rolling. So we're going to mind him this morning. Revelation chapter 21. I'm super excited about our subject matter, about the word God has given me this morning. I'll be honest with you, buddy.
Stand behind this pulpit and so thank you for making that transition. And Lord, touch my heart earlier this week on this subject, or excuse me, earlier last week on this subject matter, and it led me to it today. You know, there's no denying in this world we face troubles. We face trials. We have tragedies that come and disrupt life sometimes, disrupt the peace that we find ourselves in. But aren't you thankful? There's coming a day when we will all enter a land where we leave all the troubles behind. And that we leave all the trials behind. We're going to a place, we're going to home, our heavenly home, where those trials cannot and will not enter in. You know, according to Scripture, all of us that are believers, all of us that are born again biblically and repent of our sin, turn from our wicked ways, turn to Jesus, accept Him by faith into our life. You know and understand we are just pilgrims. Passing through. We're strangers passing through this world. I hope you don't get too close and to this old world here, because this is not our home, amen? And we're just passing through, as the song says, going to a better land one day. And there's many elements in this life that trouble us, that hinder us, and sometimes that slow down the progress that we would like to see in our life. And certainly we know this life here entertains things such as death and discouragement and depression, even at times. And certainly the devil still creeps his ugly head around and disrupts life and tries to do all he can to derail each and every one of us. But boy, can I tell you this morning, I'm excited. There's coming a day, amen. There's coming a day when heartaches no more shall come. No more clouds will be in the sky. The song says, no more tears to dim the eye. And all is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. And we sing about it. What a day, what a glorious day that'll be. I'm excited about going to heaven, you. And I'm looking forward to that day. And I hope the Word of God speaks to us this morning. This chapter alone, Revelation 21, contains more information than I will attempt to cover in one setting, even with the abbreviated time this morning. But I want to bring out something, a thought that I believe is going to encourage us and challenge us from one verse. D.L. Moody said this, and I quote, he said, "The thought of heaven has cheered the soul of many believers. Some say that we are fools to believe in heaven. But to deny heaven is to deny Jesus, for he came from heaven. It is a place of our departed loved ones in the cold, dark grave. It is to deprive millions of Christians of the greatest hope that we have. To deny heaven, he says, is equal to murder, for it kills hope. It's equal to thievery, for it robs us of our joy. It's equal to slander, because it calls God a liar. I'm thankful this morning that as a saint of God, you and I as believers have been promised of a home called heaven." And we're going to preach on that for a few moments. If you're physically able, would you stand to honor the reading of God's Word? And we're just going to read a few short verses for you this morning and then zero in on the one that will be our text. Revelation chapter 21, starting in verse 1, the Word of God says, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, 'Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God.'" Now, would you notice our text verse, verse 4? For sake of time, we'll stop here. The Bible says, "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes." How many are thankful for that truth? And you look forward to that day. God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. But notice this. "And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any pain, for the former things are passed away." Let me read one more voice in the verse. "And he that sat upon the throne said, 'Behold, I make all things new.' And he said unto them, 'Write, for these words are true
and faithful. Back to our text verse, verse 4, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are all passed away. Thank you for kindly standing. You can be seated. This morning I preached to you. I'm excited and I'm thankful for the things that are in heaven, but I'm thankful for the things that are not going to be in heaven. Amen. And so I want to preach to you just a few moments on that thought. Things that will be missing in heaven. Things that will be missing in heaven. Father, we need your help, Lord. We've come to this hour, the most important hour, Lord, of this time together. Our hearts have already been blessed through the wonderful singing that I believe has lifted up your name and magnified your name. We thank you for that, Lord. I thank you for the testimonies, Lord. My, how our hearts are touched. Lord, I'm thankful for the church. Lord, I'm thankful that you love us and your love draws all of us and your love can flow through us, Lord, and touch the lives of so many others, Lord. I think about all those in Wilson County and surrounding counties that still need to be touched by the love of God, Lord, that you can use this church and these people, Lord, in the pews that are sitting this morning. Lord, next year we have new people that are standing up here and saying, here's what God has done in my life and through my life. And he's used this church and the people of this church to do that, Lord. We're thankful for how you're blessing. But, oh, Lord, our hearts are thankful for the thought of heaven, Lord, for the reality of heaven. Lord, knowing that one day we're all going to be caught up from this old world. We're going to leave our troubles and our trials behind, and we're going to move on to a land, Lord, where there'll be some no more, Lord, there'll be some things missing in heaven. And I'm thankful for that, Lord. We're excited. I pray that you'll work in us, Lord. I'm aware of the time, but I'm also aware of your spirit. I pray you'll direct me. I pray you'll guide me, Lord. I pray you'll have me say only the things that you would have me to say today. Lord, hide me behind the cross. Preach through me and to every person here. And if there is someone in our midst, Lord, that if they leave today or to meet their maker, Lord, they're going to miss out on heaven. Oh, God, would you draw them today? Would your spirit speak to their heart, Lord? May today be the day of salvation when they come to the saving knowledge. Lord, I need your power. Put a fresh anointing upon me. Lord, as I preach your word, guide me and use me. If you see fit, it's in yourself, David, pray. Amen. There's a story told of a missionary, Samuel Morrison was his name. He was serving the Lord in Africa for 25 long years. And because of some health infirmities that came to his body, he had to make the adjustment after that long to come back stateside and end that part of his ministry. As he aborted the ocean liner that was coming back to the New York Harbor, he learned of the fact that President Roosevelt was also going to be a passenger on the ocean liner that day. And so as they began to get closer to docking back here stateside, President Roosevelt had just been in Africa for a three-week hunting trip. And Mr. Morrison had spent 25 years of his life over there serving the Lord. And so you got one over there for service, you got one over there for leisure and a little vacation time. As they come back, they begin to see the crowds. It looked as if the whole city was there at the harbor that day to welcome back, not the missionary Samuel Morrison, but to welcome back their president who had been gone on a three-week hunting trip. And so, man, the crowds were lined up. As they got closer, music filled the air and banners waved in the sky. And, man, people just went above and beyond with balloons and flashlights, fireworks. And things were just the grand welcoming home of the president. And so as they got off, and, of course, President Roosevelt had an opportunity to walk off first, as you can imagine, the place exploded in excitement and singing and music continued on. They celebrated their president coming home after 3 weeks. Another passenger got off the ocean liner that day by the name of Samuel Morrison. He walked out, honestly, with his head down. He walked out with a little tear in his eye and a little foul spirit in his heart. And as he began to allow the devil to fester in his mind and heart to the tune of things such as this. Lord, I've served you for 25 years in Africa. And the president's been over there for 3 weeks on a hunting trip and came home. And everybody seemed like in the city was there to welcome him. But, Lord, nobody was there to welcome me home. Nobody cared that I was also getting off on that ocean liner that day. He struggled this for a while. He went home. He told his wife. He said, I've just got to get along with God. He said, this is bothering me. And this went on for several days. And he was praying one day, talking to the Holy Spirit. He said, Lord, how could you allow me to give 25 years of my life over there to Africa serving you? And we come back, and there's a big crowd. But, Lord, they're not there for me. Not one person, Lord, walked up to me and said, thank you for your service. You know, thank you for serving the Lord and for touching lives over there. And we're glad to have you home. And it's in that time of prayer, he told his wife later that the Spirit tapped him on the shoulder to Samuel Morrison. For that day, President Roosevelt was coming home. But your home-going day has not come yet. When you got back to New York, you are not home, amen. You'll get that fanfare one day. Aren't you thankful when we get to heaven, there's going to be some folks there welcoming us. Samuel Morrison was not home that day, but the Spirit of God reminded him that he is going home one day where he will be welcomed there greater than we imagine. You look at the first three verses of our text this morning, and boy, our hearts begin to become overwhelmed as we read what John saw, New Jerusalem coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as the bride, adorned for her husband. What a picture that paints for us. All of us can go back in our minds to that day that we married the one we love. And man, we stood at the front of that auditorium or that place where we were married, and that bride came down. And we can get the imagery that is presented here, the bride adorned for her husband. I heard a great voice, verse 3 says, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. And we start thinking about that new Jerusalem and how awesome it's going to be and how great it's going to be. Boy, it doesn't take long for my thoughts to get in gear about the things I'm looking forward to seeing when I get to heaven. Amen. How many of you are looking forward to seeing some things when you get to heaven? Now, we know what makes heaven heaven for me is not the things, not the streets of gold, not the pearly gates, not our mansions fair, not all those things. Jesus will be the one that makes heaven heaven for me, and we'll fall at his feet. And boy, we could go on and preach on that, but that's not our thought this morning. I want to take us just for a few moments to the things that will not be in heaven, things that will be missing in heaven, because they also bring joy to my heart and I hope to yours this morning. Can I tell you, first of all, I know we don't have the points in front of you this morning, but write them down. The first thing will be missing. Separation will be missing in heaven. Separation will be missing in heaven. No more separation. Oh, death is an awful thing, isn't it? Death is something to enter this world because of sin. And can you conceive with me this morning, going to a land where there will be no more death? Going to a land where there'll be no more separation. No more sad goodbyes, amen, when we get to heaven. Death had not been a part of the original created order. We know it came, if you look at Genesis 3:19, we know it came because of the curse that came into the world because of man's sin. And I'm thankful, though, the Bible tells us both in the Old Testament and two of the prophets and also in the New Testament, 1 Corinthians, we'll go there in just a moment, that one day death will be swallowed up in victory, amen? I'm thankful for that truth, and I'm thankful that it's a reality that is coming. Hey, listen, we're going to a land one day where there'll be no more sad goodbyes. I'm not going to slow down much this morning, so you got the amen in between words, all right? We're going to keep rolling. But I'm thankful no more sad goodbye. No longer will we experience the pain and loss of death's chilly hands as it comes to take a loved one. No more tough phone calls that we receive saying, pastor, husband, wife, I've lost a dear loved one. Hey, no more funeral sermons, preachers, for us to preach and prepare and get ready for, praise God. No more funeral homes, man. They're going to go out of business in the next land. They're not going to be there. No more undertakers. No more obituaries to read. No more epitaphs to write. No more cemeteries to visit. No more graveyards to go visit anymore. Amen. Listen, none of that stuff is going to taint the glory and the splendor of heaven. There's going to be no death in heaven. Amen. No more separation. No more sad goodbyes. Never again will grief a stricken loved one stand beside the body of someone they have loved and say their final goodbye. I'm thankful separation will be missing in heaven. There'll be no more death, no more sad goodbyes. 1 Corinthians 15, we'll just go to verse 56 for sake of time, says this, so when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Well, I look forward to that day, amen. I look forward to that day. There is no more sad goodbyes. I'm telling you, when we get to heaven, no more separation, no more death. I'm thankful for that. Let's hasten on. Not only will be there no more separation. Separation will be missing from heaven, but sorrow will be missing from heaven. You see all this wrapped up in verse 4. There'll be sorrow missing from heaven. All tears shall be wiped away. The word there specifically refers to sorrow or grief of any kind. Okay, so it speaks of all pains. It speaks of all troubles. It speaks of all heartaches that we encounter and experience in this life. And truly, man, truly, we know this old world is full of those things, don't we? They're full of the trials. They're full of the heartaches. They're full of the sad times, the troubles, the pains even that we go through. Man, sometimes it feels like troubles of this life follow us like a shadow, doesn't it? We can't get away from them. Every turn, it seems like we turn somewhere and there's a trouble, there's a heartache, there's a burden that we're carrying or helping someone through. But oh, aren't you thankful there's coming a day and there's a land where there'll be no more heartache, amen? There'll be no more trouble. There'll be no more sorrow. All sorrow will be missing there. I'm thankful to know I'm going to a heavenly home where there'll be no more sorrow. Well, I started thinking about that just a little bit. That means there'll be no more sitting at the hospital waiting on that report. Well, there'll be no more, Miss Joy saying over there wondering. She sent me another encouraging text this morning saying now that Dennis Jr. is responding to those that are speaking to him and engaging him in conversation. Well, there'll be no more sitting wondering if he's going to come out of it watching a loved one recover. There'll be no more hospice care being lined up. There'll be no more rehab needed and no more caretakers coming. There'll be no more sorrow, amen? There'll be none of that in heaven. We're not going to have to line those things up. No more appointments at the doctor's office to line up. No more land of sorrow. Well, I don't know about you, but that excites my soul. No more separation. No more sorrow. The Bible specifically mentions crying. The word has the idea of an outburst or an outcry, and it refers specifically to those times when we are absolutely overwhelmed and broken by the events of life. And if we do slow down, it'd be to ask that question. How many of you have been there? Absolutely overwhelmed by the events and the happenings of life that the Lord, through His sovereign plan and love for our lives, has allowed to come into our life. And sometimes we are overwhelmed by that here, but it speaks about those times when we are at the very end of our rope and we don't know what to do. But again, friends, boy, we can run and shout a little bit. I'm thankful we're going to a land. There'll be no more sorrow when we get to heaven. No separation. No sorrow. They'll both be missing from heaven. Boy, there's something else going to be missing from heaven. Suffering's going to be missing from heaven. Suffering's going to be missing from heaven. We derive this from the word that we find there in verse 4 of pain. Neither pain will be there. The word refers to labor, to toil, the great trouble. And boy, there's several categories that I'll give you here just to bring our minds and wrap our minds around this truth. First of all, no more suffering means no more physical pain. How do you can shout right there? I mean, we're only 36 years old. Yeah. My wife gets out of bed every morning and says, oh, I'm hurting, you know, I'm hurting. No, just kidding. But some of you do that, amen, I know. It's coming from us, right? Hey, no more physical pain. No more pain. Whatever you're facing right now, how many of you can say hallelujah one day it's going to be gone? No more physical infirmities. No more physical pain. No more things that you deal with on a daily basis. Those aches and pains are gone. I'm thankful for that. And we all know somebody that we need to look at this week and say, hey, buddy, one day there is coming a day where the physical pain you're facing, the physical infirmity you're going through, it is going to be gone. But there's no more suffering in heaven. Physical pain's out of here. Emotional pain. I'm going to raise a hand. We've been there, haven't we? We know someone there. Emotional pain. They've been scarred. They've been battling with something internally in their mind, their heart. Listen, emotional hurt can be a very real thing in the lives of believers. Don't fool yourself to think that we're above it. I do believe God helps us through it, and He gives us grace and strength and mercy to pull us out of it. Man, emotional hurt, emotional stings, emotional pain is a real thing. But only here, amen. One day it's going to be gone. No more pain, no more emotional pain on the other side. Hey, here's one. How about relational pain? Relational pain. You know, as we preach through the Word of God, we don't jump over topics, right? So as we get to the passages that deal with how to heal and deal with relational pain, boy, I tell you, I say, man, listen, life is too short. Life is too short to leave this world at odds with somebody. Amen? And let's just get honest. Sometimes you got a family member you only feel like you halfway speak to. And yes, I'm not burying the hurt that's been done. This is relational hurt. It's real. It's a part of our lives. I know you're sitting there saying, well, Pastor, you don't know how wrong I was done. You don't know what they did to me. Life is too short to not make things right. Life is too short. And listen, you know, I preach, you do all you can do. Right? You can't force your opinion upon them. You can't force a reaction out of them. But you do all you can to make things right. But hey, listen, there's coming a day. There's no more relational pain over there. The person that bugs you the most here, if they're going over there, they're not going to bug you up from heaven. You're going to have those hurts as it were. And then you have spiritual pain. And boy, we could unfold that one and spin there for a while. But man, there's spiritual pain. Huh? You've been there. You've been there. It's hard times, and you feel at times, Lord, why is this coming on? Lord, why is this a part of life? Why is this got to get the Samuel Morrison attitude? Lord, I served you. Why is this happening, Lord? But hey, I'm thankful we're going to a land where there'll be no more pain, including physical pain, including emotional pain, including relational pain, including spiritual pain. Hey, I'm thankful. No more hospitals in heaven, amen? No more broken homes or almost broken homes in heaven, amen? No more hurts, no more pain, no more suffering, no more heartaches, no more broken hearts, no more trials. Hey, praise God, all that's going to be missing in heaven. And I tell you, if you can't tell, I guess from your head, amen? Things that are missing in heaven. Separation will be missing in heaven. Sorrow will be missing in heaven. Suffering will be missing in heaven. I had to go fast because that's a normal stop at 3, but I've got 2 more to go. But I cannot leave a man. See. I feel like running out there. Do you hear what I said? See. Be missing in heaven. I know we may have some holy moments in here, but I still feel the same. But I ain't one of them. If you wrap this fish, maybe from another world, and that may scare me about you, but listen, I'm thankful sin will not be present in heaven, amen? Sin will be missing in heaven, where somebody should shout right there. I'm thankful when we get home, there's going to be no more sin. Takes us back to the beginning. Can you imagine how the garden was before sin? Created perfect. Adam and Eve, and I did say Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve. Well, I read this week where a pastor put something on a sign. Of course, it's in a liberal state, and he lost his job because he said the truth about homosexuality. We live in a mess, ain't we? We live in a sin-filled, sin-sick, sin-polluted world. But we're going to a place where sin is not allowed. Amen. Sin will not enter there. The garden was a perfect place. Heaven is a perfect place. Nothing, sin will not take anything in heaven because it will not be there. And while my heart is still stirred, Wednesday night, as we're going through what the Bible says about certain subjects and hot subjects today, and we started off with abortion because of the alphabet. And I hate to say this because of me, but if you missed that, just some facts, I'm saying you need to get that DVD. You need to tell Robbie, fill out the form and get that because I believe it'll help you. But I'm telling you, when I think about what they do to these precious babies, I'm telling you that the sin in this world is sickening. And I don't know about you, but I'm tired of it. And it's time to speak out against it, to speak up, to be the voice that God has left us here to be the church. Hey, if it doesn't come from the church house, where else is it going to come from? It's not coming from the courthouse. We've seen that. God's people have to stand up and speak out against the sin that is so prevalent in our world today. It's so rampant, and people act like it's just second nature. Hey, listen, they can celebrate their sin if they want to. I'm going to preach against it. I'm going to love them, try to pull them out of it. But in the meantime, I'm going to do it on the other side, celebrating heaven's sin. It's not going to be no more. It's not going to bother me no more. It's not going to bother you no more. It's not going to tear you down, me down. It is going to be cool. And I'm thankful. Sin is coming a day where sin will be no more. That means no more temptation. That means no more struggle. That means no more battles. It'll all be gone. Praise the Lord. The sin will be listened to. Are you ready to go? Are you ready to go? Well, if I find the land, there'll be no more separation. No more sorrow. No more suffering. No more talk about it. I want the battle of sin no more. Sign me up when I'm ready to go. Well, I take purposeless without being born again. So it'll be absent of all those things. There's something I thank God for missing. Please bring me to the Lord. I'm afraid of the Lord. What else? I said, what else? The old adversary of this world, Satan himself, hear me, will not be in heaven. He might follow me to the gate, but he ain't getting in. Amen? I'm going in, he's turning around and going out, going back, going down. We would say, I'm thankful that Satan will not be in heaven. No more Satan. Listen, it's true that much of this life and what happens, man, we say it's a part of living and troubles and trials and tragedies and all those things. Disappointments certainly are, but God tell you that also the things that are caused in this life and come into us, yes, sometimes God removes the hedge and there's an adversary called the devil, Satan himself, that is after you, that is after me, that wants to destroy you, that wants to destroy me. He wants to attack us. He wants to derail us. He wants to discourage us. He wants to doubt us. Satan is doing all he can to win everybody. I don't think he'll win. It's a real fight. It's a real fight. If you don't think so, then you may not be in it. Hey, if he ain't bothering you, maybe a reason why. The devil, our adversary, boy, he desires to defeat you. He desires to destroy you. He desires that he'll stop at nothing to see you fall. Let me give you these quick, you write down the references, if you will. The Bible says in 1 Peter 5:8, he's our adversary, right? Seeking out who he can devour. The Bible says in the book of Revelation 12:10, he's the accuser of the brethren. Boy, I could run that dog for a little bit. But you think on that, what's going to happen on that day when he accuses us, but yet the Son of God steps in. Jesus steps in and says, hey, all those things are true, but I'll pay the price for that young man. It's all under the blood. He's mine. He's been bought with the blood of Jesus Christ. Hey, he's the accuser of brethren in Matthew 4:11. He's the old devil, as he's described. In Matthew 4:3, we know there, even with our Lord Jesus Christ, he is the great tempter, and he certainly does that to you and me on board every day. In 2 Corinthians 4:4, he's the God of this world. And how many of you know he's doing all he can to wreak havoc while he can? But there's coming a day when that time for him will be no more. Amen. He's going to run out of time. He's going to destroy his last life. He's going to deceive his last person. Ephesians 6:12 said he's the ruler in the darkness of this world. In Genesis, back in Genesis 3:4, we realize he's the old serpent. Listen, he's all that and so much more. Ever since as an angel, he was kicked out of heaven. You understand, he's been in opposition to God. He's been against God. He's been against God's children. He's doing everything that he can to ruin us. His role and his mission, get this, his role and his mission is to destroy your life. Look at how he's attacking our young ones. As God tarries, God help us. We raise our young children in a sin-filled, sin-sick world. With things that used to worry about and talk about in secret, now flaunt out in public and paraded as being set upon. Right, God help us. Listen, he wants to destroy us. That is his mission. Unless you believe his lie, he'll tell you something. He does not care about you. He does not care one ounce about you. And he'll paint a pretty picture. Right? He'll lure you in. He doesn't care about you. He's doing it because he wants to deceive you and he wants to destroy you. He's out to ruin you. He's out to cripple you. He's out to pull you down and make you a joke in this world. But oh, aren't you thankful there's coming a day where he will bother us no more? I'm thankful for that. The Bible says I've got to go there. Revelation chapter 20.
if you remained open, probably on the same page for most of you. Notice what the Bible says, and I saw an angel. Woo. Well, we're going to have church all over again right here. I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil, and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years and cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him that he would deceive the nations no more till 1,000 years should be afflicted. And after that, he must be loose for a little season. You said, Pastor, did you just say he bound him and threw him in for 1,000 years? But does verse 3 say he's going to be loose? Yeah, we know Scripture teaches that for a short time after that 1,000 years, he is going to be loose. And he's going to make one more effort to do all he can to destroy lives and to damn lives and take them to a sinner in a devil's hell. But let me tell you something. That passage doesn't end there. Amen. Pick up with me in verse 7 as we jump in. It says, and when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan, yes, shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is at the sand of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of saints about, and the beloved city and the fire came down from God out of heaven and devour them. Notice this, verse 10, circle it, highlight it, underline it, do anything to it you want to. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire of brimstone where the beast and the false prophet are, and he shall be tormented day and night. Notice how the verse ends, forever and ever. There's coming a day where Satan will be no more. There's coming a day where he's going to tempt us for the last time. There's coming a day where he's going to bring somebody down by the awful penalty. Why? Because he will be cast out and cast into the lake of fire where he'll spend all of eternity, praise God. There will be no more Satan. No one to deceive us. Our adversary then will be gone. No more Satan means no more temptation. No more discouragement, no more battles, no more depression, no more defeats. Oh, I feel like loading up on my old ship assignment and taking us a heavenly ride. I'm going to a place there'll be some good things missing and some bad things missing. It's a good thing they are missing. Amen. Praise God. My friends, where are you at? I could take one more place in Scripture if you have to say right before you pass the moment. Something else to do this morning. It's a reality just like the rest of it. You have a total presentation of Scripture. If those five go out and read about it and talk about it and say it down about it, we can rejoice and agree with it. And I think that tells you to read on down and pass the Scripture. He takes us to a book of life. Whoever will have faith to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, and shout and say, my name is written in. I'm thankful my name is down in me. But you know what the verse says? All of you are written in the book of life.
Going to one more time, I know the Lord is going to give us the opportunity to
I want you to experience the torments of hell forever and ever. And hellfire was not created for them. It was for Satan. But all that reject the free gift of salvation, they're also going to be cast into it.
Sitting in the family of Christ, I'm going to bless them and teach them what I'm saying. But I do not want to take a single chance on missing people and splitting people up. I don't want to invite you just to have a great protector. Accept Jesus Christ once and for all as your personal Lord and Savior. I've also been challenged to step up and say, that's what I'm asking about. I'm asking about. If they don't give it to Christ, they don't see the reality of what you preach to us. They're going to come and come to a people. Preach, I'm going to be used to God to be all the way to you. To be a people. Get my life, your father, your spirit, your heart. But the motion is so